Welcome to episode 11 of My Views Extended. I'm your host, Nadia. I'm going to start off with some not so good news this week. In Australia, there is a wife who crashed her own funeral, horrifying her husband, who had paid to have her killed. Kind of sounded like a Lifetime movie, but I was actually reading the article and hoping that it was, you know, going to be like one of those hoax things at the end, but it wasn't. It was real. He had paid to have her killed because he thought she was having an affair or something and was going to leave him, but she denies that. So he paid to have her killed. Short story, the kidnappers took her, were planning on killing her, but then they changed their mind because they did not like to kill women, so they let her go. And with the help of, I think, her pastor and a few people, they put her up, waited until the funeral, and she said, hey, surprise, I am not dead. So he is in jail. He is in prison for 9 years. So, yeah, Lifetime, that could actually be a pretty cool but cheesy movie. Maybe on Netflix or something? Who knows? But anyway, she's alive, and so that's the good news of the not-so-good news. I don't know if any of you have heard, I think it was last year or 2014 maybe, something like that. There was a man named James Robertson out of Michigan, and he made the news because he walked miles to work every single day. He walked 21 miles a day, and if you know Michigan, it's very cold. It's a four-season place, and they get a lot of snow. So 21 miles a day, every day. I think it was five or six days a week, something like that. Now, because he made the news, they started a online fundraiser for him, and then he got a donation of a car and approximately $360,000. Each weekday, and lately on many Saturdays, Robertson makes the trip to his job, where he operates an injection molding machine. And of course, instead of needing 5 hours of walking and a bus ride to get there, he can get to work by his car in 12 minutes. And according to the plant manager, Todd Wilson, his attendance has never faltered, not one day. That money, none of it changed him one bit. James is still one of the most loving, caring people I know. And that's just awesome. Yeah, 57 years old, and a lot of people are retiring before 65 these days, even though I think in a lot of places they've upped mandatory retirement age to 70 instead of 65 in many places. So yeah, 57, people would be like, oh, I'm going to retire soon anyways, and would just live on the $360,000, have a brand new car. But he still goes to work, and that's awesome. And just the fact that his plant manager and other people still, nothing's changed, and that's just awesome. It's just a really nice story that I read about, and you know, one of those update stories, I guess, of to see how people were doing after they get a windfall of money, whether through something like this or through the lottery. In some more good news, that I think it's good news and other people might think it's good news, Ben & Jerry's now has a vegan ice cream line. The flavors include chocolate fudge brownie, which sounds really good, chunky monkey, coffee caramel fudge, and PB&N cookies. And I'm excited about this, not necessarily because I'm a vegan, because I'm not, but because I should not be consuming dairy. And I know I shouldn't be consuming dairy, but I love dairy. I think there's a lot of, well, I shouldn't say a lot. I think I've gotten rid of most dairy in my life. I do use butter occasionally, but most of the time I use, substitute it with coconut oil. But I also love ice cream, even though I don't eat it often. Chocolate, and I milk chocolate. Even though I think if you do dark chocolate, I heard from a friend that if you do dark chocolate, it's vegan because they don't add milk to it, which makes sense. and what's it? Oh, and cheese. I love cheese. Cheese doesn't love me. Ice cream doesn't love me, but I love those. So I guess the top three are cheese, ice cream, and chocolate. And so that's just awesome that I can have a alternative, but that's only if it's good. So yeah, I've been searching for a good dairy-free ice cream for years now, years. And because I think I discovered it in high school, actually. I think I was around 15 or 16 that I shouldn't be eating. And I shouldn't say that I discovered. I always knew that I couldn't drink, do dairy products because I was, both my sister and I, when we were babies, we were allergic to the cow milk-based formulas. So we had to do the soy milk-based formulas. I think, yeah, after breastfeeding, my mom tried to switch us to the formula because she had to go back to work. And back then, you know, they didn't encourage you to keep breastfeeding when you were working. They're just like, here, take this and dry it up. Anyway, so she switched us to the cow milk formula, and we were both really allergic to it. Not allergic, I should say intolerant, because if we were allergic, we, you know, it would have been worse. And so we didn't do dairy products for years, and then as we got older, I think she started trying to incorporate it back. And then as I got older, I started to introduce milk back into it, and then I was like, ooh, this is why I'm not feeling that well, or this is why things are happening, and not pleasant things are happening. So yeah, I have no business eating dairy products, but I just love certain dairy products. So over the years, I've discovered the, I believe they're called So Good Brand, and they make these really good ice cream sandwiches. But I do like them, and they have a really good consistency and flavor, but I don't want to incorporate too much soy because, I don't know, according to Western studies, it's not that good to have too much soy, so I don't know. But those are a really good brand, and recently I've discovered the, it's a dark chocolate organic coconut bliss by the company Luna and Larry's, and it's actually pretty good dairy ice cream alternative. It's not as smooth as a cream or milk-based ice cream, but so far for the coconut-based one, it's pretty good. And even though I'm not a huge fan of dark chocolate, like to eat it out of hand, I don't do that. But when it's, I like dark chocolate when it's mixed in with things like, you know, but this ice cream or baked goods, cakes, mousses, puddings, that dark chocolate just gives it a really rich flavor. And you can have, I find when you use dark chocolate in baking and cooking, you can, you're satisfied with a little bit versus a lot. So anyway, I can't wait for this, the Ben & Jerry's vegan ice cream. I don't know when it's coming to Canada, but I will definitely be one of the first to try it. And if it's good, I will let you know about my thoughts on that in a future episode, and probably even on my blog. If I really, really like it, then I'll blog about it. And in some more interesting news, for all those pregnant moms out there or people who want to get pregnant in the future, there's a new study out of Spain that says the benefits of eating fish during pregnancy may outweigh the mercury risk, the mercury poisoning risk. Researchers in Spain followed about 2,000 mothers and their children beginning in the mother's first trimester of pregnancy until the children turned 5. Results show mothers who ate 3 to 4 servings of fish a week had IQ scores that were 2.8% higher than those mothers who ate less fish. The study also showed that children whose mothers ate an average of 21 ounces of fish every week, about 3 to 4 servings, during their pregnancy showed no signs that mercury in fish negatively affected their developmental health compared with the children whose mothers ate less fish. And they do state that the study was observational. It does not prove a cause and effect relationship between fish and higher IQ scores. However, the findings suggest that high levels of a compound called DHA may outweigh any negative effects of mercury, the researchers said. And the researchers will continue to follow the children in the new study until the age of 9 instead of, like in the old study, until the age of 5. And I will leave some links so you can read the entire, because it's a really long article, and read the study and this was from news.yahoo.com and from livescience.com, and that goes into a little bit about how a fish diet lowers Alzheimer's, which obviously starts from the moment your brain is developing in the womb until, you know, throughout our lives. There is some not so good news, but good news, and this pertains to animal abuse. Talking about changing the status of dogs in our society. They want to change the laws from dogs being seen as personal property to that of a sentient being with real feelings and emotions. And this is stemming not just from, of course, there's been many cases, but the most recent one stemming from a case of abuse on a dog who had its mouth and paws bound with electrical tape and was left to die in a field. This case was brought to court in Windsor, Ontario, Canada. Now the previous owner, he was sentenced to 2 years in a federal penitentiary, followed by a 25-year ban on pet ownership, which I personally think should be a lifetime ban. In recent years, and I'll just read a few quotes to help me sum it up. In recent years, science has been able to demonstrate that the mind of a dog is roughly equivalent to that of a human child 2 to 3 years of age. Like a toddler, the dog has all of the basic emotions: fear, anger, joy, disgust, surprise, and love. The idea that dogs are emotional and conscious beings that should not be abused is becoming widely recognized. When Mr. Hill was denied bail, he was placed in solitary confinement, segregated from the rest of the inmates for his own protection. Even the Catholic Church now recognizes the sentience of dogs. Pope Francis has said that animals should not be abused because we will encounter them again in paradise and we may be called upon to be judged for our treatment of them. For some of you, that may mean something. For others, not, whether you're a religious person or not. I think that's good that for many people that a major religion is taking a stance on that. That just, I think, helps the cause. And that is from theglobeandmail.com. And of course, I will leave links in the show notes. And something else that I was in the news that, and I'm going to be honest, I don't know a lot about it. There's still a lot to read and a lot I'm sure is going to be coming up in the following months and years. And of course, I will keep talking about it and updating it as more things come out and as I learn more about it. There's a group called Animal Justice, and they're a Canadian animal law organization, and they believe that veganism should be protected under the human rights law. And as I said earlier, I don't know a lot about this group yet, or about, you know, how this would work within the confines of our laws provincially, federally, but I'm not sure if veganism should be under a human rights law. And I know this is probably going to offend some people and hurt some people, and I don't mean to do that, but I'm just trying to work it out within myself how this would work, and I'm just trying to figure out how it would work within the provinces and on a federal level. I don't know if I've ever personally heard, aside from, you know, I've never heard anybody else personally that has been forced to consume meat, aside, you know, from a parent to child, because especially if you're in a certain age group, and even now, if your kid didn't eat meat, you thought they were unhealthy and they were going to die, and so literally they were forced. I've seen it. But outside of the parent-child, I've never seen anybody forced to eat meat or to starve. There have always been options. You may not like the options, but there have always been options. Now, I know that people make fun of vegans. They are verbally abused or made fun of, which is not right, of course, to do to anybody because of their personal beliefs. But I haven't come across anything else other than, you know, that being made fun of, or, you know, in a parent-child relationship because they don't understand that you can be healthy and not eat meat. Which I definitely do believe. It just has to be done correctly. I eat meat, but I know, because I've done it myself, And I've grown up with a sibling who doesn't eat meat, so I mean, I'm not, I know that it can be done. Okay, I'll take this back a second. If you're a vegan or vegetarian and you go to a restaurant, if you don't like what a restaurant serves, or even take it a step further, if you're, for religious reasons, you don't eat pork or beef, and the restaurant serves that, you don't like it, you go somewhere else, or you cook, or they're not willing to, the restaurant isn't willing to accommodate, you go someplace else, or again, you go home and cook. In this particular article from BuzzFeed.com, they used the example of what the animal rights group, a veterinary student, I don't know if she's graduating yet or she's close to graduating, she refused to euthanize a dog as part of her training. I believe the dog, she had just did a spay on the dog and then she was supposed to euthanize it. I don't know exactly why you would do a spay and then euthanize it. I could see them if you have a case that comes, an emergency case that comes in, and the dog, and then you're like, okay, student, come here and do it. I can see that, because that's part of your training and we're going to see how you handle it and if you are following the procedures that you were taught. I'm definitely on the fence about her refusing to euthanize, and I believe that she was able to get her credits or graduate as I'm talking because she put in some kind of grievance and they ended up, I guess because it was brought to the forefront in the media, they did let her pass that part of her course. But I'm on the fence about it because that is part of your training, that will be part of your job, euthanization. There are certain professions that you have to do things that you may not personally or ethically agree with it, but that's what you agreed to do when you went to school to become that profession. Should people's rights to not eat or wear animal products be respected? Of course, that's your choice. That's none of my concern. But unfortunately, becoming a vet is not always going to be about healthy, happy outcomes. Do you think that every single GP enjoyed dissecting cadavers? Of course, some people were rubbing their hands and just excited to be able to rip apart to dissect that human body. Others were grossed out, others fainted, others tried to do everything that they could to get out of it, but that's part of the training. Even though you're, for example, a GP and you're probably never going to have to open up a human body again, even in your practice, you'll probably, if you can, you'll have your nurses take out the stitches and you'll probably never have to open it up again, but that's part of your training. Where should you draw the line when it comes to personal rights and your profession living in certain societies? Like I said, I'm very on the fence. I can understand and I can empathize them not wanting to euthanize in training, not wanting to dissect. But again, how are you supposed to learn how to do things correctly if you don't do it in training? You don't want to, say for example, they let you not euthanize and then you come to a practice and you have to do it and you're on your own and you're not working with another vet in your practice, you're new, and you're euthanizing it because you don't know the right dosages or the signs and symptoms, you do it incorrectly, and the poor animal is suffering or not dying because you didn't do it correctly, because you didn't learn how to do it correctly. I don't know, but I'm sure more information will come out, and I don't know, it's just one of those things, like, that's just part of the job. No matter how much you love your job, no matter how fulfilling and happy and go lucky your job is, there's always going to be a part of your job that you hate or that's tedious or you hope to only have to do it once in your entire career. That's just how it is. And again, that was on BuzzFeed.com and I will leave the link in the show notes. On to ridiculous news. Vancouverites are fed up with perfectly good houses being torn down. Now, I don't know if you're familiar with the Vancouver, BC area, and I'm sure there are many major cities around the world who are coming up with the same problems or issues with housing. Single-family homes are very hard to find in the BC areas, and that's single-family homes that are in good condition. But you see it on a weekly basis that livable homes are being torn down only to put up brand new homes or to put up condos or apartment complexes. Although I'm very much for, in many cases, I'm very much for people being individual and putting their own twist on something. You have, sometimes you'll go down the street and you'll see these beautiful historic homes, say, and I'll just use one example, in the Victorian style. And then you'll see this right slap in the middle of this beautiful, established, mature neighborhood, a home that basically looks like, in the modern style, like with a concrete jungle look and glass. And it's like, oh, that looks really out of place. Again, it's your business, it's your money. But if I'm personally coming into a neighborhood and wanting to build, I'm going to see if my style of home that I want to build fits in with the aesthetics of the rest of the neighborhood. And I'm certainly not in with that place where, you know, like a lot of the homeowners association neighborhoods where you can't paint your door red if you want. Like, I'm not like that. I don't care about colors. But I mean, kind of go with the flow of the neighborhood, and if your style of house doesn't fit in with that neighborhood, maybe look someplace else. But yeah, I just see a lot of these homes. These homes are beautiful. Many of these homes could easily be classified as historical homes, but the cities keep okaying the teardowns. I personally think it's kickbacks, and I'll say alleged kickbacks, and those are my opinions only. But you see these homes, and they're good-sized yards, which are, again, when you live in big cities, it's hard to find good-sized yards. Nice, established neighborhoods, good neighbors, people keep take care of their properties and keep junk off the lawns. And these homes are very livable. Nothing's wrong with them. And they keep tearing them down. What is going on? What do you think about the teardowns of these older, but very well-kept and livable single-family homes in the Vancouver, BC area? Or if you live in another city that's doing that same thing, what do you think about that? And should people be allowed to buy a home and tear it down, especially if it's a more on the historical side? What do you think should be done about that? Or if anything should be done, if people should just, you know, I bought the house and I paid the property taxes and I can do what I want. If you're on that side, what do you think about that? I'm going to make a combination of foolishness on the internet and my rant. And it's going to be on, I'll just say her name once. I'll try and just say her name once. Kayla Baroque. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that wrong, but eh. And she is by the title of the article, Animal Killer Granted Community Outings. And this was done in just this past week. And I have no clue why this person, and I know many of you who live in this area, why she is even out of jail, but she is, and she's living in the community of New Westminster, BC. She is allowed out between 9 and 11 a.m. on Thursdays at a parole officer's discretion. Like I said earlier, she currently lives in New Westminster, BC. The high-risk offender will have to explain where she plans to go in a letter given to authorities and wear a GPS tracker at all times, Global News reported. And I'll just give you a list of some of her offenses. In 2002, she was sent to prison for butchering the family cat and dog. She also admitted to having fantasies about murdering a homeless person while studying at Simon Fraser University in 2010. Court decisions related to her case, describing her as a sexual sadist and antisocial personality disorder who found joy in torturing and killing animals. She's also an affectionless psychopath who isn't able to show affection or concern for others, according to those decisions. In 2013, she appealed her lifetime ban on owning animals, but was denied. Can you believe the nerve of this person? Wanted to have her lifetime ban lifted so she could continue torturing animals. What a sick, sick being. She takes pleasure from this conduct and has no insight into the harm and suffering she causes these creatures. Her condition is lifelong. It is not situational. In my view, there is nothing to support a request for leniency on this probation. She has lost the privilege of having the companionship of animals by betraying their trust in her. And this was by the courts in 2012. She is still living under 47 court-ordered conditions, including staying away from public places where children under the age of 18 may be located, staying off social media, and not owning any weapons. And even though I'm not saying her name but once at the beginning of this piece, I do suggest, especially if you live in this area, that you do take a look at her picture or pictures, because there are several pictures if you go to the Huffington Post article that I will link. And I suggest that you get to know her face. And of course, if you see her, do not harass her or stalk her, but know what she looks like. It's up to us to keep watch for the children in our neighborhoods and the animals when it comes to people like her. And I would say the same thing if you have a convicted pedophile or rapist living in your neighborhood or city. Know what they look like, know where they are, and keep a watch. Be vigilant. We have the right to know who's living among us and to keep an eye on the activities and goings-on of them. Again, do not harass or stalk them, because you don't want to end up in jail and then being watched yourself. But just be aware of these sick people that, unfortunately, the court system deems them safe enough to let out, which they shouldn't be. They should be forever locked in a jail, prison, or mental institution. And that's my opinion on that. What I am grateful for this week. I am grateful for the memory of Shrove Tuesday, or as most Canadians, and I think there's a few other places that the United Kingdom, Australia, that they also call it Pancake Tuesday. And I'm not a particularly religious person, but my family is, and my mom was. And I had a working mom, but she always found a way to make sure that we had pancakes on Tuesday every year when we were growing up. If she was working a late shift for that year, we would have pancakes and warm maple syrup for breakfast before school. If she was working a late shift, we would have pancakes for supper, which was always the best. I mean, who didn't want pancakes and syrups for supper? That's just an awesome treat. I also want to know, did any of you ever get your maple syrup warmed, or was it just me and my sister? Everybody that I've spoken to, when I talk about when we had pancakes or waffles or French toast, and we would say that our mom would warm up the maple syrup, people would always look at me like I'm crazy. We couldn't be the only ones that had warmed maple syrup. I mean, who wants to put cold syrup on delicious, hot, fluffy pancakes or waffles or French toast? That's just common sense, I think. I don't know. Anybody else get warm maple syrup? I loved, going back to, aside from the warm maple syrup, going back to when you had pancakes for supper for Shrove Tuesday or Pancake Tuesday, it was just awesome coming home to a stack of pancakes and eating as many as we all could eat. And I think at that time, I think I might have still been drinking milk occasionally, but yeah, have a stack of pancakes on a glass of milk. And my mom made the absolute best pancakes. They were super fluffy and just had a really nice flavor, and oh, they're just so good. She made the best pancakes ever. I still can't make them like hers. I try, and they're just a hot mess. I don't know, like, it's so weird, because even though I spent years watching her mix up this simple batter, I still can't do it. It's weird. It's like the simplest things when it comes to baking and cooking. I find that the simplest recipes are often the hardest to perfect. And maybe it's, you know, the intention of the cook or the baker, and that determines how well the food turns out. Maybe if you think it's a chore, or you don't really like doing it, or that you find there's a lot of pressure to make a perfect whatever, in this case pancake. Maybe that's why they don't turn out that good. It's interesting. Does the intention of the cook baker determine how good the food turns out in the end? So anyway, I know my sister, I think she said last night or the night before that she's going to make pancakes for our supper tonight. So I hope that they turn out well. I think they will. She's always was better at making pancakes than I am. So I hope everybody has a good Shrove Tuesday, Pancake Tuesday, to the start of Lent, for those of you who do Lent. And so fill up on your pancakes tonight, and good luck for the rest of Lent. And I will leave a little link from wikipedia.org, and you can learn a little bit more about Shrove Tuesday if you care to. Thank you for tuning in to episode 11 of My Views Extended. I would love to hear feedback and comments on what you think of this podcast and the topics that I've discussed. You can listen to My Views Extended at nadiajanela.com and on YouTube, where you can subscribe, like, and leave a comment. I will leave links in the show notes, and as more listening platforms are added or changed, I will let you know.